गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीवन दोज हु आर हियर फॉर द सेवेंथ सेशन ऑफ किताबनामा। आई एम रियली वेरी हैप्पी दैट द सेशंस आर गोइंग इन अ वेरी गुड फ्लो एंड वी आर ट्राइंग टू कीप अ कंसिस्टेंट रिकॉर्ड ऑफ अ गुड एंड वैल्यूएबल सेशंस ऑफ किताबनामा सिंस वी हैव स्टार्टेड। एंड टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी वेरी डिफरेंट जॉनर ऑफ बुक टुडे। We'll just wait for another couple of minutes before all the other participants join in. In the meantime, those who are here for the first time for this session, it will be my pleasure to introduce Kitabnama to all of you, those who have not been aware of what Kitabnama is all about. Well, Kitabnama is the initiative from Vibgyor, where we are trying to introduce you to one particular book in each and every session. People always find it out as a book reading session, a very normal and the stereotype one. But this is not exactly what we usually keep seeing as a book reading session. Well, there is a part of book reading definitely into it. But it is more about introducing the book to you, talking to the author or the poet of the particular book, about the ideas or the thought process before they script it down, before they publish the book for the people to read it, read them out. So it's basically finding the mindset of the author, of the journey of being the author, whether they are the author for the first time or they are experienced into it through one particular publication of him or her. So today, for this session, we are very happy to have Dr. Shomik Chaudhary. And Shomik is an assistant professor with the Calcutta National Medical College in Kolkata. He is an MD who has been awarded the Foreign Travel Scholarship, the most prestigious Scottish award by the Indian Academy. Just a moment. Yeah, so I was talking about Shomik. So he was awarded with the prestigious Scottish Award by the Indian Academy of Forensic Medicine. In 2019, he was awarded the best faculty presentation by the same body itself. So he's a researcher and he has published almost around close to 40 research papers. And his passion is writing, combining the real science with fiction in the crime genre. So this is something which is very, very unique. So he is doing his profession into this genre, and he's trying to incorporate science. He's trying to incorporate a lot and lot of fiction, the crime into this. And together, he has compiled it for a book, which is the topic of discussion today. That's House Murder for an Experiment. Well, I must say that the title itself is very, very catchy. And all of us are anxiously waiting for Shomik to introduce the book to us. So let us welcome Shomik Chaudhary today. Shomik, are you there? If you can switch on your video.
Yeah, I'm there. Yeah. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. If you can switch on your video, please. Yeah. So Shomik, welcome to Kitabnama. And I'm really so happy to have you on board. And I was literally looking forward for this session, especially because this is one genre where I think we have the sessions ready for the next few months as well, but we have still not got a genre which is of today's session. So today we are going to have a very, very unique genre, and I don't want anyone to wait further, and let us utilize the time of all the participants. So Shomik, I have given a very brief introduction about you. It's your turn introduce your book first.
Thank you, Vibgyor, for giving me the opportunity to it's a wonderful forum for discussing books, and the best thing about you is that you are discussing new authors. You are giving them opportunities to speak on their own books, and this book, which was released in January 2021, is my first novel. I have already released a second one, but that's doing well, but I'll not discuss regarding that here. I'll just discuss regarding the current book, that is House Murder for an Experiment. Now, this book is basically about clinical trials, something that is of very much of interest in the current scenario of the epidemic. Though this book was written well before the epidemic started, that is, it was started in 2018, and I was lumbering on trying to finish it off for a couple of years. It's a goodly long book. If you have seen it, it's 416 pages, almost 95,000 words. I'm clearly audible, I think. Yeah, fine, okay. So, because there's a long book, I was looking to finish it off, but getting prevarications about finishing it. And then what happened is that this epidemic came on in last year, March, April. And since I'm by profession a doctor, though I'm a teacher at a medical college, thing is that I thought while doing duty that might be I might die. And it is a natural thought process maybe in such an epidemic that the first line workers were being affected and even young doctors were dying. And that gave me the push to finish it off and quickly publish it off. Now the response has been tremendous to the book. It has got a lot of characters, about 20, 30 of characters, a multi-layered novel. It goes around a clinical trial in a research institute in a peripheral area of West Bengal. The area is actually close to my home place of Kharagpur. That is my original home place. I have been born in IIT campus there and brought up. So it's close to a place close to that, a fictional place. The place is not there actually, but it's geographically there. It's about 20 kilometers from Kharagpur, 15-20 kilometers. And it goes extending into the area, what we call in West Bengal is Jungle Mahal. Jungle Mahal area, which is Jhargram and these areas, and Shalboni and these areas, this you know. But we are going into the this area from Kharagpur. Okay, so we have an institute, a medical research institute, that also works as a private medical college, a trust medical college, and this institute is running clinical trials on this underprivileged population. Now, see, this trial is an issue that often comes. Whenever you are doing trials in a different underprivileged population or what we call the vulnerable population, there is various accusations of exploitation. Because it's a thriller novel, many of the people present here, I think, have read the book. And they know that it's a very multi-layered thriller. It's got a very good finish, they said me. They told me, the reviews tell me so. But thing is that, because these trials are sometimes run in these populations and there's a question of money. Because many of these multinational companies, many of these big pharmaceutical giants, they often try to get these trials run from the human trial part, the clinical trial part, run from the third world countries. Because of the economic and socioeconomic reasons, there the same thing goes for surrogacy also sometimes. Okay, because Nepal and the foothills of Himalayas also have been subjected to surrogacy for money, which is not the right way to go about it. So it's a question of ethics in research. And I have gone about that basic principle. The story is a multi-layered thriller. It's got running of a child death that occurred in institute some years back due to the trial done on a child by a medicine that was already banned in the Western world, but not banned, but it was under scrutiny. And the rest I'll tell as I go along. But this is the start of the story, that a person is found, that a young student there, he dies of medical negligence. Now, interesting part of medical negligence here is that their parents complain that it's an intentional medical negligence. Okay, so because it's an intentional medical negligence, there is a institution of a trial. First, there's an investigation, and a special team is set up under political and other compulsions like citizens forums and etc. protesting, and that is the start of the story. And that's where my main protagonist, I won't call him the hero, he is the forensic pathologist, a teacher in a medical college of forensic pathology, just like I am. And he starts on the special team with the policeman. Now, we have had a lot of fiction in thriller genre where we emphasize on people who are what you called amateur detectives. Now, in real life, it is very difficult to be an amateur detective. Why, I'll tell you, you know it obviously, but I'm just stressing out the point because it's an important point. Because an amateur detective will have no access to the data. Will have no access to the evidence. So that is not possible. Nobody will give you access. You might like to leave. I'm myself a very big affectionate of Sherlock Holmes or Poirot or Feluda or Bomkesh in Bengali. There has been a lot of written in this genre, but my book is different from that genre. What I want to stress is that this is more connected to real life, number one. Number two, the science part is absolutely real. The science part, the forensic pathology part, the exhumation part, everything is absolutely real. And what happens is that when you connect with this audience on a real science level, the modern audience or the recent audience that we have for books or films, which is more mature, I think, than what we used to have early on, I think would like to read that. If it is written in a proper literature form, it's easier to maybe accept and understand. Yeah, this is the start. I'd like to make an introduction. That's it. Next, I will go on as we...
This, I think, is a very, very powerful introduction. And I'm sure all our participants, those who are here, are totally like, you know, like we tell that...
You I'm sorry, shaken. LA, extreme portrait might not be very good.
No, definitely, definitely. I think this introduction was very much required. I will tell all the participants that this book is a must read. So definitely Shomik is not going to say something which will be a spoiler so that you can enjoy the book while you read, but definitely I'm sure that as he opens up or he places the card on the table, your curiosity level will grow up. But before we start, once the book has been already introduced, let me start with any of the participant to open up and say that when you read the title of the book, even if you have read the entire book today, what was your first reaction when you heard about the title of the book? Like, let the participants say, then I will share my own reaction when I heard about the title of the book. So anyone who is very much eager to say, this is an open platform.
May I start?
Please, with pleasure, sir. Please.
It is a really thrilling experience because... I have not heard about the title when Shomik, he just told me, and then one fine morning he came to me and gave me the book. Initially, I am a little lazy always, and I just thought this such a big book, it takes a lot of time. But when I started, I cannot do any other thing except finishing the book, because I am also a forensic person, and each and every thing he has written was absolutely touching. And naturally, it is written by Shomik. He's very, very close to me, and I want to admit here that he has told me repeatedly to write a review. I am not as lazy in writing something. I have tried to write, but before writing, I got the point that someone has written the same thing which I am going to write, like Partho Mukherjee and some other thing. Anyway, now I have got another opportunity. He has given me the second book also, I have completed. And I shall try to write a good review, what is appropriate. So yes. I wish him all the success, because this it is something different.
Yes,
what we
different.
Are, we
absolutely
know,
yes.
It is a different. Huh? Normal thriller or detective story has got such... something which is cooked. It is absolutely in every sometimes after you get a twist. So that is really interesting. I appreciate his writing, and I hope that he will be continue with more such books to help us
definitely
to get
good
books.
We are also looking forward that we will bring Shomik once again for his second book in Kitabnama itself. Thank you so much, sir, for your proactive reactions to the questions. I really appreciate this, and I really open up this question to some other participant if he or she wants to put.
Sir is a very famous forensic personality in all India.
Yes, I remember. Sir. I remember you have already introduced him to me while we were speaking over the phone.
Yes.
So I'm really happy to see you, sir, out here with us. Anyone else who wants to? Even if they have not read the book, actually, if somebody who has not read the book will be the best response at this point of time, that when you see a book with a name, House Murder for an Experiment, what's the first thought that comes to your mind? Anyone who wants to share? Yes, Kalolaji, please.
I have not read the book, but the title is really very interesting. Actually, I'm from a research organization, and I come across certain things which is little similar to that, not exactly. So sometimes the frustration of some of the colleagues that we heard, and some of the incidents which are happening around. So immediately many scenes just came into my mind. So I said, I'll definitely, so in the morning also I text, yes, I'm here in the evening. I'm just looking forward to this.
Yes, yes, true.
Thank you.
The same thing has happened to me. So I'll just quickly brief for my own reaction, because I really love the way the book has been like portrayed. Now, the point is, as I always say, the content of the book definitely matters a lot. But the ultimate garnishing or the publications or the finishing, that really adds up some bonus points. So here the bonus point is how well you attach the reader with the title of the book. And the moment I heard about this title when Shomik told me, the point is I really came into my mind that maybe this is something like, again, a psycho thing where you have this intentions of destructive intentions, which many a time usually happens with any kind of a depression or anxiety, which we keep seeing in different newspaper as well as different new present genre of movies that comes up. So I thought maybe this will be in relation to that. But then again, I saw it's not at all in link to that. It has more science. It has more practical things into it. And definitely it has been a very, very different the first notion, the first impression, and the final product is very different. Yes, so Teja is writing, maybe a scientist murdered a person. Okay, he is writing it up in the process of investing someone, something to save many others, and a story of him getting rid of it. Yes, okay, so this is Teja's reaction about a scientist. So that's how this title actually connects to most of the people. It will not allow you to stay away, but it will always attract. So now with those attractions already built up, today we are here. So Shomik, without wasting much more time, let us first have a short first set of readings from the book by you.
Okay.
Yes.
So I start with the beginning of the book. That will be the best. On the bank of the river was a park. It looked deserted and dark. The large trees that were there since the time, the place was a forest, made a very dark canopy. Even the new lights that had been installed recently by the administration did little to remove the gloom that seemed to envelop the park. Archishman entered the park. It seemed that no one was there. He settled down on his favorite bench behind the obelisk. He looked up towards the sky. In July, you never knew when the skies would open up. It had been oppressively humid over the last 2 days, but it had not rained. He had seen the weather reports that it was due to the El Nino effect. Whatever it was, the weather was terrible. He had found it impossible to stay in his room on this stuffy night. Now, under the starlit sky, with a light breeze blowing, he felt much better. He took off his t-shirt and remained only in his shorts. This felt better. Plugging in his earphones, he turned on his favorite music. When sleep came, he did not know, but he was dreaming of a white coast with swaying palms in which he was playing in the sea with a girl. The girl was saying something. Suddenly, the girl's voice turned masculine, husky. He woke up with a start and realized that the words were actually being spoken and quite close to him. So that is the first part.
Goodness. And you have started building the suspense from the very beginning itself in the book.
Yeah. So thing is, in the darkness came a grating, harsh voice, harsher probably as it was filled with menace. Archishman listened quietly. He tried to place the voice and feigned. Though he seemed to have heard it somewhere before, he could not recognize it. I warn you, this is the last time. This is going to cost you dear. I know all about the cheating the council. All that research into a new drug and using it to murder innocent child all those years back. You thought people did not know, didn't you? You have no proof and it was not intentional. The other voice was hoarse with anger. So I'll really leave it at that. It's pretty long. Yeah. So this is the start that somebody hears something in a park, in a dark park, unintentionally. And that's where the whole drama starts to unfold. And next, do I continue or do you want to ask something?
No. You can continue a little bit more. I don't mind.
Okay. All that research into a new drug and using that to murder an innocent child all those years back. You thought people did not know, didn't you? So I told that. Tell that to the court. You know, knew very well of the side effect or you should have. The warning from the company was issued 1 week before the medicine was used. It was there for everyone to see on the website of American Association of Pharmacology. Don't try to fool me. Maybe this will convince you. A light of a mobile screen was seen in the darkness. After a few moments, a voice was heard. It sounded more subdued than before. What the hell do you want? Let's go and talk somewhere else. Someone might hear us. It was foolish of you to call me here. Was it? Roared the harsh voice scornfully. Maybe I want to be more foolish. The voice had got fainter and almost inaudible. Archishman got up from the bench. He had heard only part of the conversation, half asleep. But by the thing that is called fate, he had heard it for sure. He would have to talk it to someone who knew all about the ins and outs of research. Only one name came to his mind. He picked up the phone and dialed the number. Only he could be trusted with such vital information. He could act if he wanted and stop this butchery of human lives. That's how he thought of this. That's where the prologue ends. So that is,
My goodness.
Please.
Now I want to ask a question. Now we have many doctors also today. So this is a question to the entire doctor fraternity. Now we understand that any kind of medicine or research, it needs some experiments. I think that's the whole crux of it, because you need to find out before putting it public whether it is having any reactions or not. And definitely every experiment cannot be successful. There are some unsuccessful attempts as well. And a few are intentional, all are unintentional. But at few times, as you have already mentioned, that a medicine which has already been marked as to be unsafe, but still it goes out for some personal benefit. Most of the time we find maybe that person is not directly linked to the doctor fraternity, but just because of their own business benefit, they push the doctors towards the wall and they make it done. I don't know how much this is true, but with the cases that I hear around, with the news that we read, I feel maybe that is the cases. But if that is true, I'm not asking whether it is true or false. How as a doctor or as a researcher, you feel at times very much helpless. I want to just have an idea about that part.
Should I say or somebody else?
You can please say first, and if somebody else wants to add up to it, I will really love it.
In 2012-13, there were a number of cases for this clinical trials in MP, in a number of medical colleges, were vitiated, and there were much issues regarding this clinical trials. It came up in the national media as well. So it was the condition where the clinical trials were being conducted for personal benefits, and it is not a wholesome scenario. Obviously, that is not possible. But there are obviously some cases where this type of errors might have occurred. Now, thing is that errors might be of two types: one is intentional, and one is unintentional. But when you are an expert in a subject, even if it is an unintentional error, and if you don't check for everything before giving a drug to a certain person or giving a drug to a certain patient, and in the clinical trial some error occurs, it is for you to report the side effects first. And if a company has somehow concocted you to getting at a trial, last stage of a trial passed, so that it can market some drug in some part, it does happen in many South American countries. It has occurred in the Asian countries to some extent. In the poorer countries, it is more common because, it is a place where drugs are anyways difficult to afford, and a difficult treatment is difficult to afford, often for many people. So it is a point that is sometimes utilized for financial benefit. That is where the premise of this story starts. But it is not the main thing, but it is the premise of the story. Because ultimately, it does happen. And for this, we have got the laws. And it is much more stringent now for the present moment. That's why I start 6 years back from the time I've written the book. That is in 2018, I had started writing, 17-18. So 6 years back means about 2011-12. Okay. So that's why I've taken the book back, because for the current moment, the laws are much more stricter. And it came on after these things came into light in 2012-13, and it was largely publicized. It is a very, you know this very well, you can verify it also, that in MP, in a number of medical colleges, there was a big issue regarding this drug trials and clinical research trials. So ultimately, made was, what was made was the newer set of laws, and it has been made more stringent so that the reporting part is made more strong. So here it is a back a case in history which can have an effect on his registration and his further career as a researcher. That's whoever this he is, I'm not saying, because this he is not what it seems to be. Okay, this is the suspense part, and various doctors and various teachers, medical teachers, forensic people have read this book, and they have reviewed it very well, and they have said that I've even got engineers, IIT professors, Jadavpur VC, all have reviewed this book, and they have said that they could not find out who it was, and they found the thing to be very interesting till the very last. And that is not very easy when you're writing a 416 page book, because thrillers are usually of not that length, except a few thrillers which are about 400 pages long in the US or UK, but other than that you find thrillers to be ending about 250 to 300 pages, okay, mostly, because it's very difficult to sustain the level of tension to the level where you can't find out who the criminal is till the end, because ultimately it has to be a marketable book and it has to become appreciated by the people, because whatever the science part is there, I have kept the science part to a minimum. Science part is correct, but what I want to stress is science part is actual science. There is no fictional part in the science part. What investigations have been done, what autopsy is being done, what the findings are, what are the recent autopsy findings, those things, there is no going beating about the bush. Okay, that is very much pointed and absolutely based on theory. Even my second book, which has got more technicalities than this, that is also very well researched, and that has been said by most people. I am also corroborating that part is the original science part. Now the story is a fiction story, so naturally it's in the garb of fiction. So it has come out it has to interest people as well. So multiple characters have come in. There are various situations. Obviously, one can talk about that feasibility of this thing and that thing. That is always there in thriller genre to be there. If you read Agatha Christie, there are various books it is very difficult to even presume. Such presumption is not there at least. Okay. So I am affectionate of Agatha, but thing is that there are various scenarios that have been pretty impossible to imagine actually. But in my book, that is not there. It is a possible scenario. And it has been verified by my forensic senior teachers. Professor Tapas Bose sir is there. I think Dr. Devay Shagas sir is also there. Maybe Parthosh sir is also there. I don't know. I can't see everyone. But whatever, they have all reviewed this book and found it to be forensically perfect. And they are all very senior forensic people, all working in the actual forensic field for many, many years. Many of them are as old as my father. So they are very much senior to me. They know much more about the subject than me. And they, I take their valued opinion as to be correct as to the science part. And other than that, I think these laws which have been made much more stringent. Now, I don't want to make this political. But thing is that after 2014, I'm not a supporter of any party. But after 2014, these laws have been made a bit more stringent. It's a fact. Now, before that, it was a bit loose. Maybe the government didn't realize that at that stage. The government has tried its best. It is trying its best still. But fallacies have occurred. And fallacies, this story is based on that fallacy only. It is not a common thing that every time doctors are out there doing murder, that is not
No. They have gone. See, the point is, this is part I want to also emphasize that doctors are not like this. There have been some incidences, but I'm sure there have been some back-end stories to it as well.
Commercial benefits as well. So there is nothing like black and white in it. There are a lot of gray zones. Doctors also take a lot of benefit. Whether I do or I don't, I'm not saying, but there are various people who take various benefits. That is also there. It is not that the doctor profession is above everything. We are also normal human beings. We are maybe good in the studies or medical or whatever. That is different thing, but it is usual that people from every profession, there will be some black sheep. It is in every profession.
Yeah. There will be some black sheep, definitely.
People will have this normal crave for jealousy and fame, and these things are normal human emotions. You can't get about that. Yes, right. Tell me, please. Sorry.
Right. Yeah. So now let everyone join. In the meantime, as we were continuing this discussion, I would just like to ask one more question. That maybe this book, as you have told, has already been found very much scientifically correct by most of the seniors of your fraternity. Now let me find a situation where even though you have not mentioned who is the ultimate culprit of this entire unwanted situation in the book, but as we find that nowadays, since the law is also stringent and we find people are very much active across social media, that's why even if on the street, if there is something which is indecent going on, people are aware about that. I may be taken in the recorded version, which will be legally putting up some issues in the later stage. So all these things were not so much predominant back in 2012-13. Now with the law, social media and all these things are predominant, and with the success of the book going across the globe, for example, if there is any foreign company who may have found some relevance to the story, even though the name has not been portrayed properly, and if in some or the other small sub clause of the latest legal litigations or rules can come back to you, and this is just a question, huh? Then how is your call onto it? So this is like, yeah, in the second session, I start with a rapid fire round. So this is just like a rapid fire question to you. So suppose if I am one of those MD of a foreign company, of a drug company, and I find myself somehow in relation to the consequences of the stories, even though like just like the movie, I think your book also has mentioned that relevance to anyone living or dead is absolutely...
Yes, it is in the fiction genre, so that, yeah, that does not apply in this, because in the fiction genre, any resemblance to anything is not to be taken as any, there is no legal suit permitted by that. So I'm being a forensic specialist and being a medicologist myself, I think I can counter that point. But the thing is that because I'm an expert in this field only, and I'm working extensively in this field only, but there is no, actually there is no company directly being blamed. It is if you read the whole book, you'll understand that it is more a personal acquisition of fame and a personal personal love and greed for this money and fame. And these are common human foibles and faults. And not, I will not always say fault. Also, we are always we are all subject to some sort of this thing. Always, that is there in all of us. So it is a temporary human weakness, if I say that is the correct word. And it is being on the part of that weakness that somebody is trying to gain a bit more fame than others. You are in a competitive world. Even in the clinical trials world, you want more fame for yourself, maybe more projects for yourself. And these are multi-billion projects many times. There are, it depends, like this corona vaccine is also there. And there are various trials being conducted all over. And various trials results are different across. And you will see so many types of regimens coming out, so many types of advices coming out. Even the government going right to left, left to right every moment. There's so many issues. So I'm not going into that because that is a big issue that come up. So I'm not going to that. But thing is that this does happen. What is the right, point right, is right. that nobody can counter the scientific truth of this. Now somebody might say, I have never done this, I have never done that. That is all right. So that is fine. But somebody has done it because it has been proven in the Madhya Pradesh case also. It was in the public domain only for a very long time. Clinical trials were a big issue. And the government stopped medical colleges from conducting trials because various specialists were directly accepting financial benefits from the companies. There is nothing new about it. It's a fact, proven fact. Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Now let me put up a very, very like a different question. Okay. I think that will give a change of mindset of whatever we are discussing till now. Now, for example, yeah. if this book has gone to a different level of success, and there has been an offer from one of the film industry, a producer comes and approaches you that would you like to share the copyright of the book, and we would like to make a movie out of it. And the question is given to you, what will be your reaction and why?
It is a very cinematic story. Two people have mentioned that, especially one is sir here. I don't think it has joined back. Professor Tapas Bose is there. Sir is there. Sir sees a lot of movies. Sir reads a lot of books. He's a big book collector. And he said that this book was very cinematic. It was ideal for making cinemas. It was very, it has got a lot of characters. And two of my students of MBBS, who are of the younger age group, they also said that, sir, this is very good for making movies. And they said it while the book was being written. They were reading it in parts, like a beta reader almost. And they said that this is very good for making movies. So this was a sort of reaction that was there. So I hope that something might come out because the book is doing pretty well. It's in the Amazon recommends best-selling books also. So I hope that something might come out later on. Yeah, we are hoping for something.
Excellent.
I'll be happy.
Now my connecting question is, if I give you the privilege of selecting the actor for the main character, who was the only one person to whom that particular guy would have trusted upon, whom would you have chosen for the role?
Role of Ryan Ray, you're saying? The role of Ryan Ray?
Yes.
The main character?
So
I think it should be Ayushman Khurrana here.
Okay. And what if it comes for the done in the Bengali industry?
I think it should be Abir. Abir is very good for suit. For
you believe me or not, I was having Abir Chatterjee in my mind.
I think he's the best suited at the moment to play such a role.
Yeah, because
that character is not as tall as him.
Yeah,
he's about 5'8", 5'9", but he's about over 6. But anyways, except the height, he's perfect. Yeah, it's a perfect. Yeah,
perfect.
Because it's a sort of a doctor, a pathologist, and a medical doctor who's got an MD, quite a few prizes like myself. So he needs to be a bit academic and a bit on that side. So I think Abir is perfectly suited in Bengali to do that.
Superb. So
one of my teachers, Parag sir, read the book. He is working with the medical film industry as a music director. Sometimes even in some movies he has acted. He's also HOD of one of the departments here in a government medical college. Maybe he'll put it across to someone that it's good for a movie. Let's see.
Yes. So we have both the A's into the two industries. One is Ayushman and one Abir. Who can be taken up. Yeah. Now, my question is, I'm a very greedy producer. And after your first book getting transformed into a cinema or a movie with a lot of success, and I have really minted a lot of money out of it. And now with the flow of, as I don't want to be keeping the same genre, and I want to keep the same staff or the same crew members, I ask you to write a book which is a genre different from this particular thing, then even though you have to break your domain of that this is the genre which I'm easy with, which will be the choice of genre which you can go apart from the genre of this particular book?
In my third book already, which I'm writing presently, because you told me not to talk about the other books, but I'm just telling because you asked the question particularly. Anyways, the third book is on a completely different topic because I don't want to be stand by any genre, because I once used to be very good and interested in history, and I have put in the conversion of heliographics of a scripture reader. It's named the scripture reader. The genre is about a young student who comes to the city from a small town in Bankura. And he comes to a premier city university where he meets his mentor in the form of a very famous professor there. Okay. And he finds some scriptures, old scriptures, because his grandfather is a priest in a very old temple in Bankura. And he's found some scriptures which is starting to translate. He's trying to get it out, the language out of the scriptures, which is written in a very, very old world language. And this heliographic conversion with this guide leads into academic confrontation at a later stage. But they finally discover some connection between the Dravidian civilization and the Indus Valley civilization. And this is the topic of my third novel, completely different from the medical, legal, or the scientific side genre. The science will be there, but more of history, more of archaeology, and more of linguistics. These are there in the third book. So it's completely a different genre.
I tried to give a googly and you just hit it a 6. So no further questions in this rapid fire round. Let us go to the second set of book reading from your end. Okay, Subhashini wants to ask something. Yes, Subhashini, you can unmute yourself.
So I had a question for you right from the beginning. The moment you said you have like 23 characters in the book, over 400 plus pages,
yes.
23 odd characters, maybe 26. So my question to you is, as an author, how do you keep track of how the characters develop over a period of time? And how do you keep the plot together? Because you seem to have kept the plot very well together till the end that one cannot guess. So how does that happen? Or how did you manage to do that?
It is not very easy. It's very difficult, in fact. It's one of the most difficult technical points, as ma'am, you have asked very correctly. And how I have done it means I have tried to develop each and every character. And the thing is that I have gotten the nuance of the characters, the details, and the development of a character has occurred somewhat what you feel in a Dickensian style, if I say so. It's not in that mode, but the style is that I have got into the small details of the characters. And what happens is I skip from chapter to chapter sometimes, keeping in parts of the that character there and a connectivity as a whole. So what happens is the reader will never lose interest, yet he will keep the track of the characters. So that is the technique I have used. I hope successfully, because many, many people have read the book and said that the plot is there together. It is not for me to pronounce on it, but they have said it's there. And many of them are very interested in books. They read a lot of books, so they have said that. But this is the way I have used. I have developed the characters right from the basic, like their characters, their mannerisms, their way of talking. Everybody has a special character. And I have tried to make that, incorporate that small things. And even the small things I find in my day-to-day practice as a medicologist, like walking in the mortuary, the walking in the attendants walking in the mortuary, they also have some special nuances, facts that are attached to their special job or character. And it is often like, I have not made a single cardboard character. What I say that is, sometimes Christie is accused of making cardboard characters. The plot is very, very good, but the characters are cardboard. Just except the one or two characters, the others were not developed. But I have not done that. I have tried to make each and every character a human being, and each person has developed with its unique characters. And I have used the interrupted sequence, means I have used from one chapter to another, I have gone through, and I think the connectivity is there throughout, and it has been maintained. Does that answer your question, ma'am?
Yes, okay. Yes, it does. In fact, I have a follow-up question, if I may ask.
Please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay.
No problem.
So when you have developed the characters with such details and such minute observations, how much have you borrowed, or have you borrowed from your real life people around you? Because
a lot.
So
I just mentioned one thing. Professor Dipankar Guharai, who is was former HOD of our place, he's retired now. He read the book recently and has given a review on Facebook. He wrote that he seemed to recognize all the characters. Many of the characters are recognizable. Actually, it is not that they're fully taken from them. That is not correct or possible or ethical also. But there were shades of the characters that were developed from various people. And that were the true, those people who know those people can probably recognize them to some extent. But it's a mixture of characters, so it's there. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
On that note, if anyone else has any questions, please try to understand. It's an open platform. You can definitely ask to show me. No problem at all. Anyone has any other question, they can just raise their hand. Anyone has? Okay, no problem. Shomik, let's move on to the second set of book reading, and I leave up to you.
Okay, this chapter one I'm opening up, and I'm starting with the first chapter. He knew it could be God or maybe one of his angels. He never knew his religion too well to be sure. He had never learned anything too well in life to be sure of anything. But he had believed with the passion of a fanatic. People could say that about him with confidence if they could say nothing else. He never thought of doubting any of the stories his grandmother told him right from his childhood. All the stories of demons and witches and yes, of course, gods. There were so many of them and they took so many shapes and forms. He knew this with certainty. It had been 1 week now. The calls came precisely at 1 a.m. He had waited with bated breath for these calls. They seemed to serve as elixir for his tormented soul. The wait was painful and sometimes he hoped that it would stop, but it never did. The voice was like that of an automaton, like recorded voice that gives gifts and whatnot from various companies. Every time coming from a new number, every time. So could never really block them off. It sympathized little. Rather, it seemed mechanical and harsh. It had a strange attraction for him. It told him things that he didn't know. Maybe it was the voice of that departed soul, but by no means was it like the voice of his daughter. Souls have no age or sex, he had heard somewhere. It had eternal knowledge, he had always heard pundits say. He had no reason to disbelieve them. Why should he, when so many educated men believed in them? This must be the soul of his daughter, guiding him to his final destiny. There was nothing unknown to them. His upbringing had taught him never to disbelieve the priests. Since his daughter had died, he felt nothing. Not even sadness or grief, now that it was a habit like anything else. Even now, the filthy house he lived in, with its floor not knowing dusting or sweeping for years, made no difference to him. But recently he had started feeling that forgotten emotion, anger and hatred. He did not know that had saved him from pain. Now with the knowledge, he had anger to act and do something that could become the goal of his life. Eating, which was no more than was required, he did, if only to keep his life for taking his revenge. He went to bed and put out the light. A low whistle-like sound from the faraway road came to his ears. He never slept well these days. It was many years he thought that he had slept soundly with his family. Those days were gone. With the death of the people he had dearly loved, sleep had gone as well. Now it was a matter of lying awake for hours before falling into a fitful sleep in the small hours. With the calls coming and guiding him towards his ultimate destiny, he could sleep even less. The phone never rang loudly. It was more like a vibration, like the stirring of a wind. He could not afford to miss it for anything. What was sleep to him when the voice said it would tell him the truth today of his daughter's death? The suspense would finally be over. He did not mind this sleeplessness. It was almost happiness for him. So this is the first part. It is starting with this. It's first two pages here.
Okay, that's really nice. And I'm sure the way you have written, the flow of writing is also very much easy to understand, even though the subject is very heavy. And many people, those who are a bit of afraid of the curriculum subject of science, can also enjoy this, because there are few things like science and mathematics, and these are the things which we even have a little bit of connection, even though we are not in regular curriculum of studies to it. So I think this will really connect to most of the people with the pattern of writing, with the way of writing, using words which are very much vocabulary.
Many have told so, many have reviewed so, and told the language is very easy. People even who are not very conversant with the English writing, those who read Bengali books more, they have read and they have found the language easy. And it goes across all age groups of people, starting from my students who are in their 18, 19, 20s to people who are in their 60s. All have read the books and they have found it easy. Not that difficult. My second one is even easier with shorter sentences. But this is also pretty easy. It's not difficult to understand. Science is not heavy here. Science is only a part.
So this is a note to all the people, those who are seeing this video across. Please try to understand. Many a times, especially we have a small blogging section in your website. We request people to write about something they see across, or they might have taken some photographs to document. And many a times I find the reservations across the mindset of the people that we do not have good expression of words. We do not have we do not have the command over flowery English words for which we intend not to write. We will share you only the photographs. You can write, we can tell. So please try to understand. The point is that English is just a language, and to express something, you do not need to always put across a very heavy or a hefty words. That's why we have synonyms. That's why we have the same expression, the same word in different formats for different kind of people. And I think when you start expressing something, that expression, the content of the expression matters a lot, rather than putting up a very flowery language. So like today, like many a times, we even find people making a joke, calling a very simple a thing that we eat, like idli or something, with the flowery words like battered rice and these and that and not. So we make a fun of it. We understand, we take it as a light moment. But the crux of it is that you can always express things with your own words in a simple manner, and you can reach out more people out of that. So many of you, those who are seeing this video right now, please try to express yourself with whatsoever vocabulary or the words you have with you. And I'm sure that once you start expressing, once you open up your mind, you open up your heart, your imagination starts flowing, and you take all your readers to your utopian world. I think that's one of the most creative thing that you can do with your imagination. So never suppress your imaginations, never suppress the creativity that you have in you, just because of a taboo in your mind, keeping it in that I'm not so much good in the English language. And once again, it's not always English that you should follow. You can even write in your native language and start writing. we want to have these sessions. Why we are bringing authors like Soumik Chaudhary today? Please try to understand. These guys are doing a different profession. They are very much on their toes. The first liner workers, as you know very much, he was also in the impression that he might not see the next morning, and which was very true. We have lost many good doctors across the nation, across the globe, and he was just one among them who was fighting the frontliner fighters for us to be safe. So if he can find out some time out to express his own imagination with a lot of cinematic situations, I think your excuses do not stand too good or too strong in front of these circumstances. So please try to pamper your creative skills, try to pamper your way of expressions, irrespective of keeping in mind how much flowery language you are using and what so not. I think, Soumik, I think this session, or rather this book, is a very lively example of what exactly I want to portray to all the people out there. And on that note, I would not request, I'd not ask to waste much more time. We can straight away go to the third set of book reading by Soumik, and then we will open up the window for some questions from the participants if they want to ask something. So, Soumik.
Yeah. I'm reading from chapter 2. The demons seem to have gone elsewhere tonight. When he went to bed, he felt a sense of relief as one feels when one's duty has been discharged. It was something like happiness, but it wasn't happiness. He was sure of that. That feeling, though now extinct for some years, he had once known. This certainly wasn't that feeling. He was probably satisfied. He felt sleepy, very sleepy. It was years since he had slept well. Even as a flash of lightning lighted up the dark night, he turned over and slept deeply. This is after some occurrences that occur. So he's getting there, he's getting to sleep, the first person. So I linked it up with that one. So I thought that would be good that if I read a part that is there. Now I go to a next part. I'll just skip some and I'll go to a third part. This is regarding the medical negligence death, starting with chapter 3, the second death that is occurring. Okay. In the hospital in Kolkata, he lay on the bed in eternal sleep. A young, fit, athletic man, he could not recover from what had seemed only a bout of food poisoning. He died in the early hours before morning light had come through the darkness. Nothing could be done to revive him, though the doctors tried everything. His father refused point blank to take away the body for cremation. He could not accept that his 24-year-old boy could die from food poisoning. There is a common belief, often justified, that people take leave of their senses when they're too sad or too angry. It is certainly true in many cases and was certainly so in this case. The famous hospital sent out their PRO. She was a lovely looking young lady in a cream colored sari appropriate to the occasion. The letters OM were printed in minuscule letters all over in black over it. Her sympathy was to no avail, and the bereaved father declared in a cold voice that he would file a police complaint of negligence against both the hospitals. That is the one that is referring him and the one that is dying in. The CEO came after that, but the stubborn father remained firm. He would go ahead with the complaint. The local PS was difficult. Why did they want to complain? What was the ground? Did he have any evidence? They tried to show sympathy, but told him that people who run such huge institutions are usually very powerful. What was the point of stirring up the hornet's nest? His son would not come back to life, would he? He must lodge the complaint at the point he thought the patient had been originally admitted. So this is the normal thing that occurs here, somebody pushing the complaint to somebody else. The media had no major news to report since the stampede at the fair. They were nosing about when they got wind of the story. The PCR vans were lined up on the main road and the reporters could be seen in the crammed narrow lane with their cameraman reporting live on the event. As nowadays, very commonly, the netizens had a heyday and though they did not know the details too well, either because they had nothing better to do or because they really felt the pain of a bereaved father, they did a good job of it. Soon, in a couple of days, intense media pressure was building up, with the channels competing among each other with talk shows on the topic. Experts were called up from every aspect: retired policemen, forensic expert, self-styled sociologists, doctors, psychiatrists, and representatives of political parties who shouted the loudest. The government felt the heat just before the civic elections. The story was built up with the channels competing among each other with talk shows on the topic. Experts were called up from every aspect. So that is the part. Indranil, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you. So I was just about to say that, as you just told before some time, that none of the characters are cardboard characters. So I think Subhashini can definitely connect that. Even he has explained how the PRO looks along with the Om written in black. So I think by the time he was reading the book, I can literally imagine the exact scene happening right in front of me. And so that's how the entire flow of the book is, with a lot of details into it, making characters alive into your conscious, and getting you also absolutely in the scene of this medical criminal sequence. So on that note, I open up the window for any questions or any compliments also, if you want to give to Shomik, because he's also up to his third book, so he needs your wishes, your well wishes and everything. So anyone wants to add up to anything, this next 5-minute window is open for speaking your heart out, and please feel free to say. Anyone wants to add something?
So I first want to congratulate Shomik, because already it has been announced that in the next Calcutta Book Fair, both the books having the Bengali translation will be released. So there are a lot of people who are, whatever you say, they're a little afraid of going through English. So if it is in the Bengali mother tongue, I think it will be more attractive and much more approachable to all. And second thing, what you have told about the law doesn't prevent any crime. Whatever be the law, the more stringent it was, but it has no effect, and all the law has got some fallacy, and whatever strictness is done by the law, because ICMR has a very clear guideline of experimentation, but people's know how to fool them. So there is always an eternal fight going on, not fight, it's a game going on between the criminals and the police. So it is one part of the thriller novels. So anyway, I must congratulate him, and he has done an excellent job. Till now, I think no forensic people has ventured into this type of things. People have written book, but mostly textbooks and other things. But this forensic novelist, I think he definitely is first in our state. And probably, I don't know how many all over India, somebody has written like that. I have to inquire.
Yes, definitely. That's very unique of him. Definitely. And on behalf of the entire Vibgyor family, I take the pleasure to congratulate Shomik, and all our best wishes to you. And we look forward that we have you again in one more session of Kitabnama, introducing your other book as well. And this entire conversation will be uploaded across YouTube very soon. And so anyone who is watching this video across YouTube right now, the recorded version, I am sure that this Kitabnama session is scheduled on alternate Saturdays. So we are meeting again on 1st of October. That is the only one change that we have done, because 2nd of October, we have a holiday, and we appreciate your family time, and to have you with us on the Kitabnama session. We have made an alteration. We are meeting again on Friday, 1st of October, evening at 7:30 p.m. IST, with a different author and a different book. And again, definitely there will be surprises for you as well. So we look forward for you to join us again. And before I end up, I would like to thank each and every participant for their wonderful cooperation and participation. And thank you so much to the entire fraternity of the first liners, the doctor fraternity, those who are doing wonderful job for all of us to have the smile on our face and relax at our home. And once again, Dr. Shomik Chaudhary, thank you so much for being on Kitabnama. So thank you so much, guys. And I request each and everyone to be very, very safe and stay safe and take very good care of your family. Take care. Till then, good night. Bye-bye.